John 16, verse 1. These things have I spoken unto you, that you should not be offended. The word offended really means to lay a trap. It's talking about one of those little stick trap things that people used to use in the ancient days, whether it be known as the snare of the fowler. A fowler was a person that used to catch birds, okay? And so it was a form of hunting. But it's like because of whatever was taking place, people can be offended. It's where we get scandalized. It trips them up. It causes them an interruption in where it is that they're going. And so Jesus is saying, I'm about to tell you all of these things because as time moves forward, I don't want you getting caught in a trap. I don't want you getting offended by me and being confused because you expected one thing and it didn't turn out the way that you expected, and that it prevents you from moving forward in the faith. Because you and I need to understand something, that there's going to be things that take place within this world, upon this earth, in the midst of your life, even after you give your heart to Jesus, especially once you give your heart to Jesus, that are not going to go necessarily the way that you expected them. And so Jesus is talking to his disciples. This is right before he's about to go to the cross, and he's wanting them to be aware because they're not even understanding exactly what's going on. He says, they shall put you out of the synagogues. Yes, the time comes that whosoever kills you will think that he does God's service. Now, I have to tell you also that this happened in the very beginning, the early stages of the church. Most of the disciples were martyred. John, the one that wrote this letter, was the only one that didn't die. What does the word martyr mean? It's really the word in the Greek for witness in the New Testament. What does it mean to be a witness? It means that your life, out of your life, out of your mouth, out of your actions, proceeds Jesus. You become a moving, operating epistle. What's an epistle? A letter. That you begin to be a letter that people read by your actions and by the words and the way that you live your life that preach Jesus to a lost and a dying world. It happened in the beginning after Jesus died and ascended to the Father, and the disciples began to live Jesus upon the earth, that people began to persecute them, to kill them, to put them in the midst of prison. And I have to tell you that should the Lord tarry any length of time, and listen to me, people are bought into the American dream, and I thank God that I was born an American. I say that all the time. My dad left some of his Cajun blood over there in Korea when he fought for this country, and I've been to other countries, and I'm so grateful I wasn't born in South America or Singapore where I turned 10, or even in Holland where I hung out for about 2 weeks while I was working offshore. I'm very glad I wasn't born in any of those places. I'm very glad that I was born in America. But I got to tell you something. People in the church have bought into this idea that everything's just going to stay the same way in America that it's always been. And I'm here to tell you that all you got to do is read the writing on the wall, and you can know that, no, should the Lord tarry and it doesn't end up the way that we expected, there will be trial and tribulation at the end of this thing, just as there was at the beginning of this thing. But I have good news for you, amen, because the same Holy Spirit that got the Apostle Paul through, got Peter through, got Thomas through, is the same Holy Spirit that lives in you, lives in me, and will also be able to get us through. Amen. He says, and these things will they do unto you because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things have I told you, that when the time shall come, you may remember that I told you of them. And these things I said not unto you at the beginning, because I was with you. But now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you asketh me, whither goest thou, or where are you going? But because I have said these things unto you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away, for if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you, but if I depart, I will send him unto you. You know, just real quick, I don't mean to be as choppy as what I am this morning, but I want to point something out. In verse 6, where it says, because I have said these things unto you, sorrow has filled your heart. I'm asking the audience something. I'm not asking you to raise your hand in a cacophonous, noise gathering situation. I don't want you to answer me is what I'm trying to say. I'm just trying to ask you a rhetorical question. Have you really given your heart to Jesus? That's something between you and Jesus. Amen. You know whether or not you've really given your heart to the Lord. I said this last week and I say it a lot of times. You know, Jesus talks about believing in him. receiving and believing in him a lot. Sometimes people don't have a very good understanding what it means to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. They think that because they believe with their mind that Jesus is real and that he died on the cross, that that's the same thing as believing the way the Bible's talking about it, and that's not true. Amen. The Bible says in James chapter 2, verse 19, you believe there's one God, you do well, but the devils also believe, yet they tremble. That means that demon spirits understand that God is real and that he had a plan, and the plan was the sending of his son to die on the cross for the sins of humanity. They understand that intellectually. Demon spirits have an intellectual capacity to understand the things of God. But just because they understand something intellectually does not mean that they have believing faith, because they can't. But you and I need to understand something. Just because you believe that God is real, just because you believe he has a plan, just because you believe that he sent his son, that his name was Jesus, and that he even died on a cross, doesn't mean that you've believed in the sense of giving your life to the faith. And when you've given your life to the faith, then you know something has happened. Because the Word of God says in Ephesians 1:13 that when you get saved, you get sealed with the Spirit Amen. Of promise. Amen. What does that mean? It means the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of your heart. Amen. It means that things are different now than what they ever were before. Amen. It doesn't mean that you're perfect. It doesn't mean that you never make a mistake. But what it does mean is this: you're different now. Amen. And the Holy Ghost, the one who scattered the stars in the sky and breathed life into a lump of clay, now has naked his home inside of your heart. He now has come to abode with you. That's what Jesus said. If any man would believe in me and my Father will come and we will abide with him. It means we will move in with him. We will sup with him. In other words, we will have dinner with him. There's intimacy and there's relationship with God in a way like it never was before. If you've had a relationship with God. And the reason I said that is because in verse 6 he says, but because I have said these things unto you, sorrow has filled your heart. The longer you live with God, the longer you start having a relationship with the Lord, the more close you become to him, Amen. The more you start to see the world for the way that it is, you start to see the beauty for Jesus, and something phenomenal starts to take place. You start to like this world less, Amen. And you start to love Jesus a whole lot more. And the reason that I'm saying that is this, is I'm just being real with you. See, because I didn't always feel this way about Jesus, even after I gave my heart to him. Even after I went up to the altar that night in that church in Berwick and bowed my knee and gave my heart to the Lord, I'm just being real with you, I did not always feel the way that I knew about the Lord. There was always one more thing that I needed to do. You understand what I'm saying? Oh, I just need to go ahead and get married. Oh, I got to have children. And then one thing, you know, now I need to have grandchildren. There was always something on this world that was preventing me from wanting the Lord to come back. It's just not time yet. I got some more living to do. But the reality of it is that whenever you become to the place where Jesus becomes the beauty of your heart, where your whole life, amen, is focused upon him, something happens. Your heart gets gripped with a little bit of sorrow from time to time when you see the things that are going on in the earth, and you're longing for the presence of God. That's what's happening to the disciples. If you could imagine them on the level where they are, they've been walking with him physically. You understand that we spend the majority of our life searching for something upon this earth, Amen. Trying to fulfill yes. ourselves. Yes. Amen. With an empty heart, we seek and search and snatch and claw and try to grab and get a hold of things that are going to bring fulfillment and happiness in the midst of our life. I mean, I don't have to really break it down to you can fill in your blank, because each and every one of us have a different blank to fill in. So for some of it's vehicles. For some of it's cars. For some of it's clothes. For some of it's relationships. For some of it's a party. How many people have tried through altering through chemicals the neurology of their brain in order to try to find some kind of fulfillment or some numbing of some type of pain, to try to find something upon this earth to make things different than what they were, only to find out that it was all futile and that it left them empty in the end? The disciples found Jesus. The one that the scriptures spoke of. They walked with him. They talked with him. And now he's telling them that he's going away. And sorrow has filled their heart. They don't want him to leave. Could you even imagine? I mean, you and I can't wrap our mind around it because we weren't there. But I'm telling you, the dead got up and walked again. The physically blind, this was not anything to not be expected. They expected this each and every day. The physically blind were able to see again. Those that were lame were able to walk again. Amen? And the truth is that he's still doing that for people today. Amen. And many times it's in a spiritual sense. Come on, somebody. Help me out here. Amen. See, we are all focused on wanting to see the physically blind see. But I'm here to tell you that Jesus will make your spiritually blinded eyes be opened up, and that you would be able to see the things about the kingdom of God, and that you previously who could not walk, that you would be able to walk for Jesus today. And whenever God moves into your life and he begins to do those things, I don't know about you, but when he did it for me, I became so grateful, so thankful that, listen, I was focused on him and I wanted to be with him and wanted to be in his presence. Amen. And many times things on this earth, they just don't do it for you anymore. That's the context of where we are in this passage of scripture. He says in verse 7 though, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you, but if I depart, I will send him unto you." The idea behind expedient is that it's profitable. Amen? Yes. It's a profitable thing that I go away. Because if I go away, the Holy Spirit's coming. Mm-hmm. See, God has a plan that has to move forward. And sometimes it's contrary to our plans. God's plan is moving forward upon the face of this earth. What is his plan? He's creating an eternal family. He's bringing people into the fold. God wants those who are lost to be able to see. God wants those that are lost to be able to find their way. And part of that process required that Jesus, that Jesus died, be buried, resurrect from the dead, and ascend back to the Father. And when he did that, the Holy Spirit came. Yes. Now the message of the gospel can go forward across the globe. Amen? Amen. And it can begin to affect people's lives in each and every area upon this earth, that people would be able to hear the truth of the gospel. It says in verse 8, "And when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment." The word reprove means to convince. It means to bring it to trial. The world. Who's the world? It's all the people that you've been hanging out with. It's all the people that don't know Jesus. It's all those that have not been born again. That's who they are. One of the roles of the Holy Spirit is to put them to trial. Put them to trial for what? To prove to them of sin, verse 9. Oh, and this kind of preaching doesn't do well in the modern church. People don't want to hear about sin. Well, I'm here to tell you the Bible is full of directing us and realizing that sin is the problem. It's the barrier wall that stands between the unbeliever and the holiness of God. And there's only one prescription that's ever been written in order to remove that barrier. And it was the life and the offering of that perfect life upon a cross, and the death of Jesus in your place and in my place, and our faith in that allows the sin that we receive from Adam to be removed and for relationship with God to be restored. Listen to me, the Holy Spirit, that's one of the ministries that he does. He wants to put people in the world to trial and prove to them about sin that's in the midst of their life. And listen to me, why? Because they believe not on me. Now, let's just stop for a second. I really didn't plan on doing all this, but I just can't do it. It's the Word of God, and you just can't do the Word of God justice. He says, of sin because they believe not on me. Now, in the midst of the world that we live in, that is a bunch of fancy words to describe it, pluralistic society. What does that mean? There's a plurality of gods. You can't talk to somebody today, even in little old South Louisiana. See, it used to be all you had to do was contend with people that believed in the Catholic faith and the differences between Catholicism and Protestantism. But nowadays, no, that's not the case. Everywhere you go, you're dealing with people who have a plurality of ideas and believe that there's many ways to God. And whenever you begin to talk about those types of things, you begin to be labeled as a hater. And, you know, it's like, why can't I go towards Allah? Why can't I go towards Buddha? Because Jesus said right here in verse 9, of sin because they believe not on me. Because Buddha didn't die for sin. Allah or Muhammad didn't die for sin. Krishna didn't die for sin. And I got news for you. You won't find Jesus' bones. because they weren't in the tomb. Hallelujah. When the disciples went back the next day, he was resurrected from the dead. You won't find his tombs in the, you won't find his bones in the tomb, but it wasn't that long ago I read in a paper where they moved Buddha's bones from one place to another place over there in Asia. Buddha's bones are still on the earth today. You can go and look at them if you want to. I got better things to do, but nevertheless, you can find Buddha's bones if you want to, because Buddha didn't rise from the dead, because he wasn't the answer of the Father that was written, hallelujah, to take care of the problem that stood between man born of Adam and God. And the answer for that problem, once again, was Jesus. And if you don't believe on him, you still remain in the midst of your sin, because the payment for it has not been paid. Amen. He says, of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. What does that mean? Jesus' resurrection and ascension is proof that he was the righteous one offered by God. Right. He had no sin. Death had no right to hold him down. It was inevitable. He was coming out of the grave. The resurrection is proof that the cross worked. Amen. The resurrection is proof that Jesus paid for every sin that was ever laid upon man's account. And it proved that Jesus had no sin. It proves that the Father accepted the sacrifice. Hallelujah. And listen to me. If you have been sealed with the Holy Spirit, like I talked to you about in the beginning of this message, guess what? The Holy Spirit lives in the midst of your heart. And you know Jesus resurrected from the dead because he lives alive in you. Amen. And he's brought life to you. He says of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. In other words, whenever Jesus showed up on the scene, now the judgment of the evil one, because the judgment of sin has been pronounced, and ultimately all those who choose to go the way with the evil one in the end will also be judged. Verse 12, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore said I, that he shall take of mine, and shall show it unto you. A little while, and you shall not see me, and again a little while, and you shall see me. Because I go to the Father. Then said some of his disciples among themselves, what is this that he saith unto us? A little while, and you shall not see me. And again, a little while, and you shall see me. And because I go to the Father. They said, therefore, what is this that he saith? A little while, we cannot tell what he saith. Now Jesus knew that they were desirous to ask him, and said unto them, do you inquire among yourselves of that I said, a little while, and you shall not see me, and again a little while, and you shall see me? And this is really the passage that I wanted to preach to you this morning. Verse 20. Verily, verily, I say unto you, that you shall weep and lament, but the world shall rejoice. You shall be sorrowful, but your sorrow shall be turned into joy. A woman, when she is in travail, has sorrow, because her hour is come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembers no more the anguish for joy that a man is born into the world. And you now therefore have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart shall rejoice, and your joy no man taketh from you. Amen. And this morning, for a little bit longer, I want to preach to you a message that I titled A Time of Travail. Father, in the name of Jesus, once again, we come to you in prayer, Lord, and I pray that you would use me as a vessel, Lord. I yield my tongue to you, and I pray that you would fill my mouth with the words of the living God, not the words of a man, Lord, but the word of God, that you would speak to your people, Lord, your flock, your sheep, oh Lord. I'm just merely an under-shepherd, Lord, that you have called, Lord God, to speak forth the truth, and I pray that you would be with me, Lord, and that you would speak through me, Lord, as I give my life over for you, for the calling that you've given to me. In Jesus' name, I pray. So what I really wanted to talk to you about was having to do with this woman in travail. He declares that while a woman is in travail, that there is great pain. As a matter of fact, surrounding the thought of travail, which literally means to bring forth, in this case, obviously, that was being brought forth as a physical child. It's being used as an illustration. But what he's talking about spiritually is the fact that there's going to be a time frame of sorrow, but then at some point in time, the child's going to be brought forth, and it's going to turn into rejoicing and happiness. And what is that time frame of rejoicing and happiness? Is whenever they are able to see him again, when they're once again in the presence of Jesus. Amen. And the truth be told is that what he's speaking to you and I today is this, is that as a woman that's in labor, there's a season of sorrow. There's a season oftentimes of travail and pain and anguish, but that at some point in time, that's going to give way. Amen. To happiness and joy. And he wants you and I to understand the same thing today that he was speaking to his disciples then. Amen. And so I want you to know that if we look a little closer, we're going to notice that the followers of Jesus are experiencing pain and the world is experiencing joy and rejoicing. But once the baby is delivered, all of that is going to be flipped around. If you also look back at the passage, maybe later, I can just tell you right now that surrounding the idea of travail, which means to bring forth, as though, you know, the earth can travail, but it has the idea of labor connected to it, but it's to bring forth fruit. But surrounding this concept has many words or adjectives describing various things. Some of the words are sorrow, anguish, pain. And then at the same time, we have the words joy and rejoicing. Amen. Those words, sorrow and pain, if you look at them overall in the context of what they're talking about, it gets to the point where it's a physical mourning that's taking place. Some of the words mean the beating of the breast. Have you ever been in so much discomfort, so much pain, so much mourning that you see yourself emotionally distraught and crying out that way? There's no better illustration to describe this. And one of the words right there actually does it, is the loss of a kindred. What does that mean? The loss of a person that's very dear to us. I can remember that I had a couple. If you've never experienced that, then you don't even know what the preacher's talking about. I can remember that there was many times for much of my life, yes, some people passed away that I was relatively close to, but not really closely connected to them. You understand what I'm saying? They were family, but didn't have a close connection to them. But whenever someone who was very close to me died, my sister and my father, and the way that it happened, it became a whole nother situation. You understand what I'm saying? It caused great grief and pain and sorrow in the midst of my life. As a matter of fact, whenever a woman is in the midst of labor, truthfully, she can't really think of anything else. And listen to me, whenever you are facing pain, you can try to tell her, oh, baby, it's going to be all right. It won't be long, and the baby's going to be born. She don't, she'd probably slap you upside the head at that moment in time if you tried to tell her something like that. You cannot, I don't think a woman could if she wanted to. They try to get her to take deep breaths. They try to get her to focus on some spot on the wall, and I guess maybe that helps. I don't really know. Thank God I don't have to deal with that part of it. But what I'm saying is, you understand what I'm getting at. When a woman is in the midst of labor and giving birth to a baby, then there's not a whole lot more that she can think of other than the circumstance and the situation that's taking place right there. Yeah. The reality of it is that when you and I are on this earth and we find ourselves in the midst of circumstances like that, that doesn't have to be giving birth to a baby. This is an illustration. It's not always the death of a loved one. But whatever it is that we find ourselves in the midst of, we have a tendency to be so focused on only that. We cannot even get our eyes off of anything else other than the pain that's connected to this immediate circumstance. Somebody can try to tell you, hey man, if you'll put your hope and focus on Jesus. That's what I loved about that song. Y'all might not be able to make the connection to it, but that's what I love about us singing about Jesus, the song Cornerstone. That whole song, in my opinion, is a lyrical message of what I'm preaching this morning. Yeah, I understand the song is more about a sea voyage and the fact that storms show up in the midst of that voyage. Amen. But yet at the same time, there's a foundation. He's the cornerstone. Yeah. That's how they didn't pour concrete back in those days. They had a cornerstone. And built upon the cornerstone is where they built the foundation Jesus is the cornerstone of the foundation. Amen. And if you build your life upon Him, upon this gospel message, amen, that even though you're in a voyage and you find yourself where stormy gales rise up in the midst of the sea, the scripture says in the book of Hebrews, that's actually a scripture passage that says, the anchor holds beyond the veil. Hallelujah. You and I have good news this morning that even though some, you ever been on a boat out in the ocean or in the Gulf of Mexico even? I've been on work vessels before where you were tied up and the seas start, man, and I'm telling you right now, it gets rough out there, and whenever those seas will pull that boat and you see that nylon rope, whenever it hits hard and it'll make the most god-awful noise, and you're like, man, this is some serious seas out here. Thank God that rope's holding, but sometimes them ropes don't hold. Sometimes them nylon ropes, as thick as they are, they break. But I got good news for you this morning. Jesus ain't letting go. There's an anchor that holds beyond the veil, and it will never break. He'll never let go. Hallelujah. He was obedient to the Father to the end, and because He went before us, you and I have hope. Hallelujah. That we can hold on to Him in the midst of whatever it is that we're going through. Amen. Listen to me. I know that sometimes it's painful. I know that just as a woman in the midst of labor, you have a hard time getting your eyes. Sometimes it's finances. Come on. Sometimes it's relationship issues. Sometimes it's death of loved ones like we talked about. Whatever it is that life brings your way, listen, try to slowly remind yourself, oh man, I got to get my eyes off this circumstance. I got to get my eyes off this stormy gale. I need to look back to the anchor that's beyond the veil. I need to look to the one that never lets go. I need to look to the one that is my source of strength. I need to look to You, oh Lord Jesus. I cry out to You and ask You to give me the help that I need to get me through this thing. Amen. While a woman is in labor, she can't think of anything else. It's so severe. It's impossible to think of what's next. She becomes consumed with the here and now and can't focus on the joy to come. But as soon as the baby is brought forth, amen. As soon as the baby is brought, as soon as the victory is given, as soon as God turns the page in that chapter of your life, even on this earth, listen to me, ultimately the context of what we're talking about is the final day, right? We're talking about the final day when we will see Jesus again. But in the midst of this life, I have to tell you, there's going to be interruptions along the way. And there's going to be circumstances along the way that are going to try to get your eyes off of the Lord and onto the midst of your circumstances. And I'm just here to tell you this morning that Jesus, amen, He's the one that we need to look to. He's the one that we need to focus on. Amen. I want you to know that the thought of a woman in travail and its relationship to the kingdom of God is actually found in several different places. And one of the places that I wanted you to turn to, and if Sandy could put it up on the screen, is in Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. This is the kind of stuff that I like to talk about. Connections in the Bible. Connections between the New Testament and the Old Testament. This is the kind of stuff that I like to teach. If you don't love the Bible, if you're not like really like kind of like what I'd call a word nerd and really want to get into the scripture, you're probably going to get tired of my preaching after a while. I hope you don't, but I mean you might. But this is the kind of stuff that I like. It says in Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 through 4. It says, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars, and she being with child, cried, travailing in birth, and pained to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads, and his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. So what I want you to see is, look what it says. It says, there appeared a great wonder in heaven. It's almost like the way that I've viewed this passage of scripture is that there's a film being projected in the midst of the sky. Now, many people say that there's a certain constellation of various stars, and I wouldn't doubt it, that God put the gospel in the stars. I really wouldn't doubt it. I'm not smart enough to figure all that out, but I'll tell you that there's a good positive. God is. God's certainly smart enough to do that. But what I will tell you is this, is that the book of Revelation also speaks in veiled language, but is telling us another story. I believe that this passage of scripture right here projects something that's certainly going to take place in the future. A time frame whenever God is going to deliver his people out of the midst of tribulation before the wrath of God hits the unrepentant world. And we see a picture of this dragon who drew a third of the stars out of heaven. That's representative of the third of the angels that he took with him, and that they now we are in the midst of a spiritual battle. But I want you to know that this passage of scripture also reflects backwards. It's as though there's a flashback that's taking place, and it's telling us something about something that happened in the Old Testament. What is it telling us about? Well, if you could turn with me to Genesis chapter 26, verse 4. Actually, Maybe she could keep that on the screen, and if you have your Bible, you could turn to Genesis 26, verse 4. Sorry, Sandy, if you wouldn't mind going back to Revelation 12. In Genesis 26, verse 4, it says right here, "I will make thy seed to multiply as the stars of the heaven." That's what it says in Genesis 26, verse 4. "I will make thy seed to multiply as the stars of the heaven." Let me go to Galatians chapter 3, verse 7. Mm-hmm. This is God. In Genesis 26, 4, God is talking to Abraham. And he told Abraham, this is before there was ever a nation called Israel. You understand what I'm trying to say? We're talking at 2000 BC, before there was ever a nation called Israel, God gave Abraham a promise, and he said that I will make your seed to multiply as the stars of the heaven. What is he saying? Your offspring is going to be greater than all the stars that you can see in the heavens. And one time he told him to step outside of his tent, he told him to look up in the sky, and he said, you see all those stars? That's what your descendants are going to look like. Now if you go to Galatians chapter 3, verse 7, look what it says. "Know ye therefore that they which be of faith are the seed of Abraham." Now listen to me. Let's just do a little bit of teaching for a second. In 2000 BC, God promised Abraham about his seed. He said that your seed is going to be like the stars. In other words, there's going to be a whole bunch of them. But now look right here. Now we're talking 2,000 years later, we're talking about 65 AD, after Jesus has already died on the cross. This is about 2,000 years later, somewhere around there. And the Apostle Paul, given revelation by the Holy Spirit, says, "Know ye therefore that they which be of faith are the seed of Abraham." Now, can you see now how many stars there are in the sky? Now, can you see that it's not just the nation of Israel that came forth out of Abraham? See, Israel didn't come forth out of Abraham until his son, his grandson, Jacob's name was changed to Israel, and they wandered in the wilderness, and then God finally brought him into the land. That's a whole other story. But that through the ages, Jesus finally showed up on the scene. He came forth from the nation of Israel, and through him, people are being born again and becoming part of the family of God. And the fulfillment of the promise that God gave to Abraham was that just as the stars in the sky and their multitude, so would the descendants of Abraham be. And the Apostle Paul says, "They which be of faith are the seed of Abraham." Not just the Jewish people, but all those that would believe in Jesus Christ, yes, as their Lord and Savior, because that is ultimately the plan of God.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, if you go to Galatians 3:16 now, real quick, we'll see this, that it says, "Now to Abraham and his seed," his offspring, "where the promise is made, he says, not into seeds as of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ." I know I use this a lot, I quote it a lot, but I wanted you to see it. I wanted you to see what the Apostle Paul was saying. The Apostle Paul was saying, he didn't say seeds as plural, meaning just the nation of Israel, but that seed, which is Christ. See, it's through your faith in the Christ, in the one that God promised, that creates the family of God, that allows you and I to be born out of the world and into the marvelous light of Jesus Christ. It's faith in what he did for us at the cross that allows us to be, well, lack of better words, be given birth to. And sometimes there's great travail even in that process. Great labor even in that process to get you and I, hard-headed self. Come on, somebody. Can the preacher still tell the truth? Hard-headed self, stiff-necked, don't want to do nothing God's way, wants to do everything man's way. I want to do it my way. I'm going to do it my way. Well, guess what? There's a whole lot of people that split hell wide open doing it their way. You're not promised tomorrow. Listen, there's no praying you out of purgatory, man. That's not the truth. The gospel said, Jesus, Paul said, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Today's the day of salvation. Amen. Multitudes, the prophet said, multitudes are in the valley of decision. Today is the day of decision. Amen. Somebody's going to choose whether or not who they're going to serve. They're going to either choose to believe the gospel and by faith give their heart to the Lord or not. So what I wanted you to see back to Genesis chapter 26. Verse 4, that the promise was made to Abraham. He said, I will make you, your seed to multiply like the stars of the heaven. Now remember, we're back in Revelation 12. I'm not trying to confuse you, but part of that picture that we saw, don't go to Revelation 12, go to Genesis 26. Part of the picture we saw of that woman in the sky had to do with 11 stars, had to do with the sun and the moon. The connection I'm making right now is that Abraham was promised that his seed would be like the stars in the sky. But I want you to see this, and it says right here, and will give unto your seed all these countries, and in your seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. So the ultimate fulfillment of this is that through Abraham came Israel, through Israel came Jesus, and now all nations of the earth can be blessed in Christ if they individually choose to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Amen. But look at Genesis 37:9. See, this is the direct connection I want to make in the Old Testament to this Revelation 12 passage that we're looking at about this woman that's in the midst of travail. All right, because I want you to know that even the plan of God is going through a birthing process. There's pain connected to this situation. In Genesis 37:9, it says he dreamed yet another dream. Well, who's dreaming? Joseph. If you've never read it, I'm going to tell you. Y'all know the story of Joseph? Some of you do. Joseph, what was the big thing about Joseph? What kind of clothing did he have that made him so different? He had a coat of many colors. His daddy, Jacob, who was Abraham's grandson, Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel. We won't get into all that right now, but that's where Israel came from. Jacob had a son named Joseph. And guess what he did? He made Joseph a coat of many colors. He didn't make it for all them other 11 boys. He made it just for Joseph. It's not really a good thing to show favoritism to your children. But he gave Joseph a coat of many colors, and his brothers hated him for it. And not only that, Joseph kind of wore it proudly. He had a couple of dreams, and the Lord had a plan for Joseph's life. It's a great plan. I wish we had time to talk about Joseph, but we don't. God used Joseph in a mighty, powerful way. He's a type of Christ. Amen. He's the suffering servant like Jesus. Yes. He was treated improperly, yet he saved his brothers in the end. Amen. Amen. And that's what Jesus came to do. Amen. He took upon himself flesh and blood to save his brethren, you and I, hallelujah, from the grips of hell, from the grips of pain, from the grips of sin. But the story goes is that Joseph has a dream, and look what he says in his dream. And he told it to his brethren. And this is what he said. Behold, I have a dream. I dreamed another dream. And behold, look what happened. The sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. What does obeisance mean? Reverence. Talking about to bow down. Bow down as to a king. What's he saying? This is what his dream is. His dream is, my daddy's the sun, my mama's the moon, and the 11 stars are my brothers. Because there was 12 of them. And in my dream, y'all all bowed down to me. So he's over here kind of like in a way, I mean, I don't know that that's the way you're supposed to handle it. It was true. But we got to be careful on the way that we approach people, even when we're speaking the truth. Because they're thinking, I'll say, wait, hold on a second. Who made you the leader here, Johnny Come Lately? You can't just walk up in here to handle things the way you want to handle things. No. But this is the point that I want to make. I want you to go back to Revelation 12 passage. He's taught because in his dream, there was a sun and a moon, and there were stars. And what I want you to see in the Revelation 12 passage, Revelation 12 verse 1, there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, upon her head a crown of 12 stars. The Catholic Church says this is Mary. This isn't Mary. This is the woman known as Israel. If we go to the next verse. This is a fulfillment of the Joseph dream. She being with child cried, travailing in birth, and pained it to be delivered. What's going on here? We're seeing a visual in the heavenlies that God is showing us of salvation history, where a nation called Israel, known as a woman, that is a fulfillment of Joseph's dream, is pregnant with child, meaning God had a plan, and Israel served as the womb that would give birth to Messiah, who would deliver the world, hallelujah, from its pain, yes, from the circumstance, and those 12 stars represent Joseph and will represent the 12 tribes of Israel. And what I need you to know, though, is that there's also, if you keep going, there's a dragon. There was another wonder in heaven, a dragon who took a third of the star. So the stars sometimes represent the seed of Abraham. The stars sometimes represent fallen angels or even angels. I can show you multiple scriptures where it says that in the book of Job and other places. I can prove it through the scriptures. You're just going to have to take my word for it this morning. But what I want you to see is there was another wonder in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his head. Go to the next verse. And his tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. What I need you to understand is this. As you're traveling upon this earth, in the midst of this voyage, you and I need to understand that just as the disciples felt sorrow like a woman that's in the midst of labor and travail, even the plan of God upon this fallen earth is in labor and giving birth to this plan. And that there's an opposition to the God that we serve. There's an opposition to the God that we serve. Is Jesus called him Satan. And one of his biggest ploys has to do with presenting false doctrine. He presents, what is doctrine? Instruction. What is instruction? This book right here. Amen. You can say you love God all you want to. You can say you know the Lord. But if you don't know this, you don't know God. I'm telling you right now, we live in the midst of a time frame in the church. Don't get me wrong, we all start off not knowing anything. It's a process of learning, amen? And sometimes we learn fast, sometimes we learn slow, but we need to be learning, amen? And what I want you to tell you, what I want to tell you is that much of the church now, all they want to do is learn through experience. They just want to experience things. They want to just feel things. I'm not going to get into that too much this morning. And they really want to experience and feel things at the behest of not knowing the Bible. I've seen multiple videos of prominent preachers that have congregations of over 20,000 people. Now listen to me. Why would somebody want to listen to a little preacher in South Louisiana who might have 42 people in the congregation versus somebody that has 25,000 in the congregation? Because I'm going to tell you something. People think when they see 25,000 people, he must be doing something right. Something's right there. Just like whenever you turn on the television, you flip through the Christian channels and you see people sitting in gold chairs with gold chandeliers and all this other kind of stuff. And it's like, oh man, they must be doing something right. Look, they rich. No, that's the signs of the world. The world offers riches. The world offers something that looks good to the naked eye. But in the reality of it, whenever Jesus in John chapter 6 said, my flesh is true food and my blood is true drink. What is he talking about? He's talking about, I'm about to go to the cross. And if you're going to have spiritual nutrition, you're going to feed on me. He's not talking about vampirism. You're not going to eat true flesh and drink true blood. He's not talking about transubstantiation, where some kind of hocus pocus takes place behind a pulpit in some type of a church. What he's talking about is, I am true spiritual food. And if you want to know the Father and you want to know the truth, things of God, you're going to have to feed on me. Hallelujah. And what I need you to know is that most people don't understand that. But the scripture desires to teach us. But many people, they don't want to take the time to learn the truth. Instead, it's a new phenomenon. We're just going to fill it out. And whenever he said that, guess what happened?
Rolled out.
They left them. They rolled out. Thank you, Joy. They rolled out of town. That's exactly what they did. And then he turned to his disciples and what he said. He said, you going to leave me too? And Peter said, where will we go? You alone have the words of life. I'm here to tell you, amen, don't buy into the lie that it's all about just experiencing and feeling something good. Because let me tell you something, that lying devil, he can make you feel some stuff too. He's a spiritual being, and he can make you feel goosebumps, and like the Cajun people call it, the frissons. It can make you feel all kind of stuff. But the reality of it is that if it ain't backed up in this word right here, then it isn't the Lord. Amen. Amen. It's the Holy Spirit. I believe in feeling the presence of God. I love the presence of God. But it needs to line up with the word of God. Amen. Amen. Praise God. So, so this woman in the scripture, we're seeing that this enemy is coming against it, and she's travailing in pain to give birth to this plan that God has written, even in the heavenly realm, for all to be able to see. Amen. And one of the ways that he does it, like I said, is through false doctrine. I want you to go to 1 Thessalonians with me, because I'm talking to you about the fact that the word travail is not just in the book of John, but the word travail is in the midst of the whole New Testament. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. Now, what this letter is about, the Apostle Paul wrote this letter to this church that was in a place called Thessalonica, and people had told them that the rapture had already taken place. And the Apostle Paul was writing this letter to correct that false doctrine. Alright? And so what he says, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you. In other words, you ought to know the times and the seasons that are coming. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. You are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night nor of darkness. Because we are the children of light, the children of the day, we have been given the illumination of the Word of God and the illumination of the Holy Spirit to give us revelation, that we would be prepared even in the end days, that we would not be caught up in false doctrine, that we would not be caught up in lies that would bring confusion into the midst of our lives. The reality of it is that the world is going to be caught up in the travail. You see, there's a flipping that takes place. Jesus told his disciples, he said, that you're going to mourn and have sorrow, but your sorrow is going to be turned into joy. That now the world rejoices, but then they are going to be in sorrow. Because then the script's going to be flipped. And the travail of the labor of the woman that was given birth to the plan of God, and the travail of the labor of you as believers who were going through the journey in your relationship with God and came across stormy gales and came across circumstances where you felt like you were literally delivering a baby sometimes, is going to be flipped, because one day you're going to be with the Lord and the pain of this fallen earth is going to be far behind you, amen. But at that point in time is when the trouble for the world that refused to repent and refused to give their heart and their life to Jesus is going to just be beginning. Now, I'm going to close actually with a couple of different more scriptures. I want you to know that whenever we think about endurance, see, the Lord Jesus is telling his disciples in John 16, he says that you're going to be going through some things, but you need to endure. And guess what? As you endure, there's a hope for joy on the other side. If you turn to Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, towards the end there, Hebrews chapter 12, just a couple of books before the book of Revelation at the end. Hebrews 12, verses 1 and 2. We're talking about joy now. We're talking about Jesus' joy. But it was joy that was built upon suffering. This is what the Word of God says about Jesus. It says in Hebrews 12, verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Now, what I need you to know is that if you go back and you read chapter 11, that what the author of Hebrews talked about was, he talked about men like Isaac and Jacob. He talked about the prophets like Isaiah, who was sawn asunder according to tradition. He talked about those of the Old Testament that were of the faith, that went through great turmoil and trial and tribulation. The reason that he wrote that in this letter was because in this New Testament letter, these Hebrew people had previously been Jewish people but had converted to Christianity. And now in their conversion, they were being persecuted by their families and by the society that they were living in the midst of. And many of them were tempted now to go back to their former way of life. It's kind of like if, you know, it's sad to say, but in America, you know, we kind of wear our feelings on our sleeves. And it's kind of like if we got saved and we truly loved the Lord and all of a sudden all our podnas started clowning us. And we were so worried about our podnas and we just couldn't like separate ourselves from them old boys because they were just so cool and we just loved them so much. Or, you know, whatever, they were my boys, man. Yeah, we really hung out. We did our thing. That now all of a sudden all the people that I used to hang out with are turned against me. They're laughing at me because now I said I love Jesus. And so because of all this persecution, I can't take it. Now, it was much worse for them. Like, their own families were disowning them. A Jewish man, if you converted to Christianity during that day, guess what they did? They had a funeral service for you. You weren't dead. They had a funeral service for you as though you had died because you were now dead to them. And the reality of it, and then they wouldn't give you jobs, they wouldn't, it was bad. You understand what I'm saying? Whenever you read the book of Corinthians and Paul's taking up a collection, he's taking it up for the church of Jerusalem, for the Hebrew Christians that are being persecuted against. But here our partners, they don't love us no more. And so now we, because of the persecution, are going to be turned back, or people laugh at us, or people look down on us. You understand what I'm saying? I've dealt with some of that. You know, I know that we all deal with that kind of thing. I didn't want people to laugh at me or make fun of me. I always wanted, you know, we got an image that we want. No, this is what Jesus did. Jesus endured the shame. It says in chapter 12, verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. In other words, people have gone before us. Let us lay aside every weight and every sin that does so easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. There's weights in their sin that get in the way of the race. Amen? The scripture says that sometimes there's things in the midst of our life that aren't necessarily sin, but it's a weight that holds us down. You ever try to run a race with a weighted vest? It's probably not the wisest thing to do. It's going to slow you down. Sin and weight in your life is going to slow you down. The writer of Hebrews is telling us we need to lay that stuff aside. And instead of focusing on that, this is what we need to do. Look unto Jesus, verse 2, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. See, what I wanted you to see right there is this, is that he endured. Just as a woman who's travailing in pain to give birth, amen, and on the other side there's joy, Jesus endured the shame of the cross. You understand he hung naked on the cross? Do you understand that the Old Testament law said that whoever hangs on the cross is considered cursed by God? Do you understand that the religious leaders walked by and reviled him? They laughed at him. They said, hey, you who said that you could rebuild the temple in 3 days, get yourself down off of that cross. He said that he would save others. Look, he can't even save himself, as they laughed at him and mocked at him. But he went forward with the plan of the Father. Why did he endure the shame? Because there was joy that was set before him. What was the joy for Jesus? Oh, that he was going to be able to sit back up on a throne in heaven? Come on, somebody. He already had a throne in heaven. The joy that was set before the Lord was seeing you, seeing me, seeing the fact that he would be able to purchase, hallelujah, salvation for humanity and have a relation, and that you and I would be able to have a relationship with God, and that even though we might have to go through the travail and the labor of a woman and the pains of childbirth, that on the other side there would be joy whenever the birthing process was over, and that you and I were reunited with God in heaven as the family of God. There's hope on the other side, is what I'm here to tell you. Amen. Praise the Lord. So it says right here that's what Jesus did. He endured so that you and I could endure. Amen. I want you to turn with me to Philippians 3 as we close in some of this. Because one of the things that I was trying to tell you about is that dragon that was in the sky and showing that he was in opposition to the plan of God. And I made the comment to you that The way that he works so often is through lies. Through lies and deception. Through false doctrine or instruction. And I want you to know that it was already happening in the early church. And it's still happening today. I'm telling you, you cannot trust the majority of what you see on television.
Amen.
You cannot trust the majority. I'm talking about preachers. I'm not even talking about the History Channel, dude. If you're getting your theology from the History Channel, you're in trouble, bro. And I'm not even talking about that. I'm talking about the preachers that are standing behind television. I'm not saying that there's not any good ones, but what I'm trying to tell you is that the majority of them are not good.
Amen.
It says in Philippians chapter 3, let's just go ahead and start reading, and I'll try not to do too much commentary like I like to do so that we can get through the passage, okay? It says, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed, is not grievous, but for you it is safe. He was saying, I'm going to repeat myself again, and I hope you don't have a problem with it, because you know what? It's a smart thing for me to keep on repeating to you the same thing time and again so that you really get it down in your nose. Amen? Beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the concision. The word concision there is a play on words in the Greek language, and talking about the difference between a mutilator versus a circumcision. There were people that were going around telling them that they had to be recircumcised, but what Paul was saying, in order for holiness. Just like there's preachers today that preach another way towards holiness through works or whatever the case. And what Paul was saying is they are trying to circumcise people through a true godly circumcision. They're mutilators of flesh. They're going to turn you away from the truth of God by getting you to go towards something that is really ungodly, because circumcision is not righteousness anymore. Circumcision is something that was outdated whenever Jesus died and he gave us his righteousness. That's the kind of stuff that was going on. He says, for we are the circumcision which worship God in the spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh.
Amen.
Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. What's he talking about? The flesh. People try to make themselves holy through what they do. They get involved in all the ministries of the church. They go to church at least 3 times a week. They raise 2 hands instead of 1 hand. They read more Bible than everybody else, and they'll let you know about it. They pray until the wee hours of the morning. There's nothing wrong with all of those things. Hallelujah. When you meet somebody that's sincere and praying and spending time in the presence of God, you know it. When you meet somebody that spent time in the Word of God, you know it. But when your motives are thrown off, whenever you're doing it because you think it's making you more holy than the guy next to you, you're in the flesh, man. And you're trying to promote yourself. You're trying to elevate yourself instead of elevating Jesus. That's a problem. John the Baptist said, I must decrease so that he might increase. There's a big difference between the two. But that kind of stuff was going on. People were elevating themselves, trying to do things in the flesh. What Paul's trying to say is that if anybody had a right to glory in the flesh, it would be me. Look what he says in verse 4. Though I might have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinks that he has whereof that he might trust in the flesh, I more. Why? Because I was circumcised on the 8th day. Of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law of Pharisee. According to the people of his time, Paul was on a fast track to being a major religious leader of the time. He was a scholar. He was born of all the right stuff. You understand what I'm saying? From an earthly perspective, from a fleshly perspective of what's going to impress people according to what they see,
yes.
Big churches,
yes.
Gold chandeliers, everybody falling out, all of this stuff happening. Come on, do I believe in being slain in the spirit? Yeah, but you find it one time in the New Testament. And how are we going to be? You ain't going to find it in the New Testament. How are we going to build doctrine on that kind of thing? You understand what I'm saying? How are we going to build the foundation of our faith on something that you won't even find in the midst of the New Testament? Yeah, people think they hadn't even had church unless people are all falling out and calling around and doing whatever it is that they're doing. I'm here to tell you that the gospel sets people free. Amen?
Amen.
He says, circumcised the 8th day, he says, verse 6, concerning zeal, persecuting the church.
Yeah.
I was zealous for the things of the law. I was zealous for the things of the Old Testament, but I was wrong. I was coming against the church. He says, touching the righteousness which is in the law, I was blameless. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. That, I mean, you know what that is. He was talking about a pile of poop. All of this stuff from the past, all of the fact of my original birth, all of the fact that I looked so good to the naked eye, to everybody that was looking at me, that was nothing but, lack of better words, a pile of poop. Compared to understanding Jesus Christ, compared to understanding who he was, amen, what he did, giving my life over to that. I turned it all away. If you could understand the sacrifice that this man made, you would appreciate it more. Beaten 5 times by the Jews, beaten 3 times with rods, shipwrecked and left in the water overnight, in prison, nakedness, coldness, stoned and left for dead, all because he loved the Lord, all because he had to tell somebody, one more person, about the glory of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And what it did for him, and how it changed him. Hallelujah. How it transformed his life. Thank you, Jesus. He goes on to say, yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. Now, real quick, because I know we've really said a lot this morning. We just try to bear with me for a little bit. We're talking about a woman in pain. We're talking about a woman giving birth. The travail of labor. We're talking about the fact that there's going to be circumstances in the midst of our life sometimes that are going to cause us sorrow, anguish, and pain. But in the end, it's going to give birth to joy and rejoicing. The Apostle Paul is saying this, that fellowship of his sufferings. Jesus was persecuted because he was in opposition to the leadership of the day. Whenever you truly give your life over to Jesus, I'm not talking about some little nominal, yeah, I raised my hand one time in church. No, I'm talking about you gave your life to the Lord. He's part of who you are now. You talk about him. You live for him. You start to make people make funny faces whenever you're talking because of the fact that you're talking more, yes, about Jesus than, yes, you are the saints who are going to let you. Lord, I hope they don't let you down today, but they probably will let you down today. Jesus is the anchor that holds beyond the veil. He ain't going to let you down today.
Amen.
But part of the sufferings, look what it says right there, being the sufferings make us conformable unto his death. To die as he died. I mean, he died physically, but what it's talking about is the fact that we need to die to our old self. Do you understand that? You realize your old self stands in the way,
yes,
of the things of God.
Amen.
Sometimes the travail and the labor of this woman and the pain that's being caused caused you, as part of that process, to be conformable to the death of Jesus. Because when you're in pain, when you're in anguish, when you're in the midst of trial and tribulation, you start to look to the Lord. Lord, I need you. I need some help over here. And he starts to reveal to you the problem, and the reason that you're in the midst of this mess is because of you, son. Yes, it's not always because of you. That's not what I'm trying to get at. But what I'm trying to say is that many times, the reason that we find ourselves in the midst of circumstances is because of what we've done, some of the pain that we've brought upon ourselves. Does that make sense? Yeah. Come on, somebody, work with,
amen,
me here.
Amen.
Amen. And whenever that happens, he's showing, no, you need to die. You need to die with Jesus. Let the old man born of Adam die with Jesus at the cross, be buried with Jesus in the tomb, so that you can be that you may know him, verse 10, and the power of his resurrection.
Yes.
In order for you to walk in resurrection life today,
amen,
hallelujah, and be part of the resurrection tomorrow when the joy really comes, you're going to have to be conformable to his death today.
Yes.
You're going to have to be one with him, hallelujah, at the cross. This is not an easy process. There's pain involved.
Yes.
There's labor involved. Verse 11. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Then he goes on to say, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do. I forget those things which are behind. Forget the pain. Lord, give us grace,
yes,
and strength,
yes,
to forget the pain, to forget the failures, to forget where I was and to reach forward unto the things which are before. He says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He's gonna flip the script. He's gonna focus now on the things of God. He's gonna look forward to moving in the direction that God's having him move. Amen. Let us therefore, as many as be perfect, be thus minded. And if anything you be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. In other words, sometimes there's gonna be things in your own heart and mind that you think are right. But the Holy Spirit will give you leading and guidance. He will show you right from wrong. Amen. Nevertheless, where we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule. Let us mind the same thing. He said we all need to be like-minded. We all need to think the same thing. Not brainwashed. We need to understand this.
Yes.
You understand that we are a new creation, that we're a new people, and that we're completely different than the world.
Amen.
And this is how we learn what makes us different than the world is the Word of God. He goes on to say, verse 17, brethren, be followers together of me and mark them. The word mark there in the Greek is scopio. It's the idea of a scope. Put the scope on them. Mark them that which walk as we have and use us for an example. Whenever you see someone who's living for the Lord and you see that they're sold out to Jesus, like the Apostle Paul was, you're supposed to mark them and you're supposed to realize they look different. Sometimes people laugh at them. Sometimes, but you know what? Maybe they're the ones that are heading in the right direction.
Amen.
And maybe everybody else is headed in the wrong direction. You ain't gonna find a perfect man. Listen to me. Don't put your scope on a man thinking that he ain't never gonna let you down. Because then you're gonna disappoint yourself and say, oh, the whole thing was fake. You're gonna wanna throw your papers in the air, throw your water. Oh, it was all fake. Nothing really worked. Look, the man fell. He wasn't even really for real. No. Down. Keep your eyes on Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith, hallelujah, the anchor that holds beyond the veil. Everybody's looking for an excuse. Oh, I put the scope on him. Preacher told me to put the scope on him, and I did what he told me. Look what he did. No, that's not an excuse, man. You're going to answer to God one day, hallelujah, and mankind will let you down, but Jesus will never let you down. Hallelujah. He said, look at this, verse 18. For many walk of whom I have told you often and now tell you even weeping that they are enemies of the cross. Look, why are they enemies of the cross? Look at this. Whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things. See, this is the complete opposite of what it was really supposed to be. We started off in the Gospel of John. And Jesus told us that there was going to be times of trial, tribulation, travail. Jesus told us that there would be pain and anguish and sorrow, right? But in reality, and this is happening even in the modern church, many preachers' messages have come to something physical, earthly. Everybody wants to fix your earthly things. I was thinking about this the other day, and I'm closing with this. I wanted to go back to John, but I'm not going to do it. That whenever I've looked at false doctrine, I noticed this the other day, and I might have even mentioned it to you, that in the prosperity message, you know what the essence of it, the prosperity message is? It comes from the word of faith stuff. It was, give me more stuff. Earthly stuff. You could confess with your mouth and become a little God, and you could confess blessing upon your life. Now the focus isn't Jesus. The focus isn't the fact that he endured the shame of the cross for the joy that was set before him, and it wasn't some regal crown where he could sit on a throne because he had that before he ever became flesh and died on the cross. No, the joy was the plan of God and being obedient to the Father. That's why true disciples have a desire to be obedient to the Father's plan. Amen? But the prosperity message says, give me more stuff. And the practical message says, I need you to fix my stuff. Preacher, if you ain't going to preach me a message that's going to tell me how to get my electric bill paid, how to get me my car bill paid, or how to take care of the things that I have going on in the midst of my life right now, then I ain't got no, I don't want to talk about no spiritual stuff. I don't want to talk about, what you talking about Jesus getting up inside of my heart and changing things in here? I'm fine. I need you to change him. I need you to change her. No, God needs to change you. Amen. Prosperity help, give me some stuff, practical, fix my stuff, and then hyper-charismatic, I want to see some stuff. Show me some stuff, man. I want to see some signs and wonders. I want to see people falling and flopping, and I want to see people barking and crowing, and I want, why you want to see that? I don't really know, but that's because people flock into that kind of stuff. I want to see this, I want to see that. No, you know what I want to see? Yeah, help the lame to walk, Lord.
Amen.
Those that couldn't lift for you before, give them spiritual feet that they might be able to walk. I want to see the blind be able to see. Lord, those that couldn't see you before, I pray that you'd open their eyes and that they'd be able to see the truth of your gospel. Hallelujah, and that what you're doing on this earth.